Before I get into my one-point message, somewhere I have a one-point message. I have so many things up here in my one-point message. This past week, I had a really interesting conversation with a doctor, a very smart lady doctor, and I was talking to her, and it's amazing how religion, the point I'm sharing with you about what I'm getting ready to say, was how religion contradicts itself. And this doctor was telling me, a Christian doctor, was saying that, you know, some people are saying that you don't even have to be born again, that everybody's ultimately going to be reconciled to God, and that you don't need to accept Jesus. She goes, but I don't agree with that, because the Bible says he separates the sheep and the goats, et cetera, et cetera. And I was totally agreeing with her. And I told her, I said, that's called universalism, also known as ultimate reconciliation, and it's a lie from the devil. You know, you must be born again. You must accept Jesus. And then I took it, here's what I did with it. I said, yeah, there's another thing in the body of Christ that when people say God is in control, I go, that's just as wrong. It's actually the same thing. And of course, that caused her to stop and pause and think about that, because I think that's what she believes. I said, if God is in control, then why would a person go to the doctor to try to get out of God's will? If God's going to do what he wants anyhow. If God's in control, why would we pray? If God's just going to do what he wants to do. And I went down this whole list, and I told this lady, I said, I believe that is the most dangerous doctrine in the body of Christ. I go, because it produces passivity. God is not in control. That's why we pray. Amen? In fact, I was thinking this week as I was coming out to the office one of the mornings, I was thinking, isn't it amazing that God gave man absolute control with no strings attached? Isn't that amazing? I think of a person raising a child in an insane, you know, drug environment or whatever. God doesn't control that. Isn't that amazing? That's why the church, I love what Roger was communicating, was that we need to do, because if we don't do, nothing gets done. Amen? See, that's what grace does. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15:10, I labored more abundantly than you all, but it wasn't me. It was the grace of God given to me. You know, so not understanding that will produce passivity. God is not up in the sky pulling puppet strings, controlling what people do. I tell people all the time, I think I told that lady, and it kind of took her back. I said, if God's in control, he's doing a pretty bad job. Amen? You know, and there's people think evil doesn't exist. They think, well, all people are basically good. Are you telling me that those Islamic nutcases that lowered those people down, those 25 that they accused of spying, that lowered them down into acid? That's evil. There is a devil and there is evil. Amen? And you know, and that's just the truth. And I think man's heart craves the truth. Amen? And I think the body of Christ craves the truth. Amen. So I just wanted to share that with you. Let's get to the message. Philippians. Nope. We'll go to Philippians 4:4, but first I want to go to this one. We were there last week. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16. We were here last week. I want to show you this one more time, because we're going to get a running start. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16. If any man see his brother sin a sin, which is not unto death. 5:16, 1 Corinthians 5:16. For what did I say? 1 John. That's what I meant. 1 John 5:16. You know, I saw first, you ever do that? I saw 1 John in my head, and I said 1 Corinthians. You ever done that? I have. There we go. If any man see his brother sin a sin, which is not unto death, we talked about this last week. Every time you see that word unto, it's the Greek preposition pros. It means facing. Facing death, okay? If any man see his brother sin a sin, which is not facing death, he shall ask. The one who sees his brother sinning the sin that's not facing death, he shall ask. The one praying, the one interceding, he shall ask. And he, God, will give him life for them that sin not unto death, or those who sin not facing death. Okay? That's really not my point, but I want to say this. That's what he's saying. If I see somebody sinning, but it's not a sin that's facing death, I still need to pray for them, right? And God will give me life through my prayers on behalf of that person that I'm praying for. Remember when Jesus in John 20, after his resurrection, told the disciples, whosoever sins you retain, they're retained. Whosoever sins you remit, they're remitted. You know that Greek word for remit is actually the same word, aphiemi, that's used for forgiveness. Now, I can't forgive sins, but I can forgive consequences through intercession. Come on. How important is our praying? How important is our praying? You know, when you pray for a lost loved one, a lot of times we're praying that, oh, let everything just go great. Let the goodness of God leads men to repentance. Romans chapter 2, verse 4. The goodness of God does lead men to repentance, but a lot of times you can't see the goodness of God if things in your life are going okay. The analogy the Lord gave me is, he said, picture a really awesome flashlight, a really bright flashlight, and you take it out at noonday when it's the brightest part of the day, and you turn that light on. It's an awesome flashlight, but you can't really tell because it's already bright out. But take that same flashlight out at the darkest part of the night, turn it on, and it's going to make a huge difference, right? See, that's how it is with the goodness of God. A lot of times people can't see the goodness of God when everything in their life seems to be going okay. That's why Paul, at one time, he loosed somebody to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, two times, that their spirit would be saved. Now, I'm not saying you do that all the time, but a lot of times we need to stop. We need to be led in our praying. Amen? The ultimate goal is that people come to Christ. A lot of times, I heard another story about a prayer group, and I didn't mean to go this long on this, but this is good. They had this prayer group going, and they were praying for this guy who was totally away from the Lord, you know, shacking with this woman, all the different things. They were praying for this guy to get born again or to come to the Lord. I think he had served the Lord, if I remember the story right. And they were praying that he would get his life right, and he would have a relationship with God, et cetera, et cetera. And they went and visited him, and he came to the door and said, we know things are bad and it's not going good. He said, hey, things are going great. You know why? They had been praying in their prayers, and they had been praying that things would go great and that he would not experience any consequences of his path. And they got together, and they said, we're praying wrong. And they pulled back all that prayer, and they began to pray that he would feel what he needed to feel that wasn't good, so he would see that the consequences of this lifestyle were not good. Almost immediately, the guy came and said, what did you guys do? You changed something. You're praying different. So my point in saying all that is we need to be led in how we pray. This idea of praying, oh, just pray that, oh, everything goes, oh, love. Listen, a lot of people won't get saved when you pray like that. They need to see the wages of sin is death. Going your own way separate from God is not a good thing. Amen. But that's what I was after. There is a sin facing death. I do not say that he shall pray for it. I believe the sin facing death is when you turn away from Jesus. Now, what does that mean? Here's my point. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. What does it mean? What does it look like to turn away from Jesus? Anybody know? This is so simple. Simple, simple, simple. Simple. I'll show it to you from this verse. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, rejoice. What does it mean to turn away from Jesus? What does it mean to rejoice in the Lord always? You could say it like this. Rejoice in the Word always. And again I say, rejoice. To turn away from Jesus for a believer is to turn away from the Word. Now, this is not like, well, there's different areas. You know what I'm saying? You can turn away from Jesus. This doesn't mean you're going to go to hell. This doesn't mean you're going to lose your salvation. That's not what it's talking about. But if I turn away from Jesus in any area, I will experience death in that area. Amplified Bible, Romans 8:6. Watch this. To rejoice in the Lord always is to rejoice in the Word. Psalm 119, verse 162. I rejoice at thy word as one who finds great treasure. Jesus is the Word. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 1:14, the Word became flesh, dwelt among us. He is the Word. Amen. See, every area that I find and I say, no, I know the Word says this, but I got a better way. I'm turning away from Jesus in that area, and I will experience death in that area. That's simple, isn't it? But boy, is that powerful. Every area, this is why the Word of God is so important. Now, I know we talk about this a lot. You can search the Scriptures, Jesus said that, and you can miss Jesus. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the Holy Spirit. We're understanding that Jesus is the Word. But the Bible is the written Word. He is the living Word. The Bible's the written Word. Jesus himself, in Matthew 4 and also Luke chapter 4, when being tempted of the devil, the living Word quoted three times from Deuteronomy from the written Word. How powerful is the Word of God? Amen? See, what religion does is separate Jesus from the Scriptures. Once you take Jesus out, then it's all you got is a bunch of rules that you have to keep, or you think you do. But Jesus is the Word. Amen? Jesus is the Word. Rejoice in the Word always. And again, I say rejoice. Now, that scripture I quoted a little bit earlier, yeah, we'll keep that up there. But that scripture I quoted a little bit earlier about out of Psalm 89:34, my covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that is gone out of my mouth. You know what that means? I sat there the other day. I have to be healed. I have to be. Because God can't break the covenant. Are you hearing me? I have evidence. The Word. The Word said. Now the mind of the flesh, and then I got another one I'm going to. But the mind of the flesh, well, let me give it. The King James says, to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. The Amplified says, now the mind of the flesh, what is the mind of the flesh? Which is sense and reason without the Holy Spirit, is death. What is death? Here's what I'm after. Death that comprises all the miseries arising from sin, both here and hereafter. What sin? Adam's sin, the fall of the world. All the miseries that we see it all around us all the time, right? How many know we live in a broken world? All the miseries arising from sin, both here and hereafter. Amen. But God says, you have a different way. You have something above that. Now, Psalm 138, verse 2, King James, please. I'm trying to make one point. Everybody say one point. To rejoice in the Lord is to rejoice in the Word. To rejoice in the Word is to rejoice in the Lord. All the promises of God are yes and amen in Him to the glory of God by us, 2 Corinthians 1:20. All the promises are yes and amen. That's why it's so important to be in the Word. Great peace have they which love God's law or God's Word, and nothing shall offend them. Psalm 119, verse 165. Isn't that awesome? Over and over and over. How high does God esteem the Word? You know who the Word is? Jesus, right? The Word became flesh, right? Now watch this. I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. At the name of Jesus, Philippians 2 tells us, every knee shall bow, right? But what gives the name power? The Word. The Word. The Word. The Word. You've heard the saying, you're only as good as your word, right? The Word. That's what we talked about out of Hebrews 6. God cannot lie. Now, any area that I turn away from the Word, I will experience death in that area. Let me give you some examples. I wrote some down. For example, well, let me before I do that, let me give you 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, King James, and we'll go to verse 4. Oh, this is so good. Golly, if you get this. You know, I've been carrying this little scripture book around, and I'm not kidding you, it is so powerful. God will give you one verse and it'll jump at you. It'll jump at you. Now watch this. Preach the feelings. Preach the latest philosophy. Preach the latest Christian fad at the Christian bookstore. Have you been around for a while? You've seen a lot of them come through and go? You know, all the different God chasers, prayer Jabez, all the different ones that have been. And there's nothing wrong with them. I'm not saying that. But you know, the Word of God is consistent. Now watch this. Preach the word. Be ready or instant, in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Doctrine. How important is this? Very. Next verse. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. They will not put up with sound doctrine. They will not put up with sound doctrine. I got up early this morning and started studying the fear of the Lord. And I thought, and I did a post and I said, isn't it amazing what you can get from the Word of God when you just let it talk to you instead of trying to fit it into some preconceived belief system? Isn't it amazing? There's a lot of people now that think, well, we don't fear God. We do what we want. We're under grace. No, you're under stupidity if that. No, I'm sorry. I'm trying to be nice. I really am nice. But that's ridiculous. Amen? The fear and reverence of God, the Bible says, is a treasure, Isaiah 33:6. It's a treasure. It's a treasure. Paul talked about it in 2 Corinthians 5. The fear, the reverence of God. We need some reverence of God in the grace camp. Can I get an amen? Amen. Amen. Grace is not rebellion from law. Grace is empowerment, man. Now watch. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust they shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. Next verse. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. They had to be in the truth to turn away their ears from truth, right? What do they turn away from? The Word. Just that simple. They turn away from the Word for their own ideas. Any area that you or I turn from the Word when we know. Listen, none of us have it all figured out. I'm not saying it like that. But God gives us direction in the Word. This is why you need to be in the Word. Not to earn points with God. Jesus has got all the points you could ever earn. But to hear, to see what God says so you can go the right way. Look at this. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 28. In the way of righteousness is life, and there is no death. Let me read this from a pastor friend of mine. His name's Ron Allen. He's a great guy. And this is what he says. Many people have resisted the Lord and found themselves in a heap of trouble. Not that the Lord created the trouble, but resisting him does. I'm leaving that hang. God doesn't create the trouble, but if I go my own way, that's resisting him, and that creates problems. The Bible says, he that has friends must show himself friendly. If every time somebody tries to befriend me, stay away from me. I wonder why I don't have any friends. I'm reaping death in that area. Amen? See, to rejoice in the Lord is to rejoice in his word. Great treasure. Amen? Not that the Lord created the trouble, but resisting him does. People often resist the humility of coming to church. Oh, we're beyond that, brother. We are the church. Don't ever say that to me, because I might accidentally do that. I'm good. All right. All right. The humility, submitting to each other. You know, these are all God. You know, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. You know what pride is? Exalting my word and my idea above God's word. God resists that, but he gives grace, more grace, to the humble. Who are the humble? Those who submit themselves to God's word. Look at it. James chapter 4, verse 6 and 7. I want you to see this. That's a powerful verse. And the way of righteousness is life, and there is no death. Isn't that awesome? Remember what death is? All the miseries arising from sin, both here and hereafter. But God gives more grace, wherefore he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace unto the humble. Now look at this next verse. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. How do I submit myself to God? I submit myself to the word. Isn't that simple? But that is profound, man. You know, we say, look at the next verse. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. How do I draw nigh to God? I draw nigh to the word. The word says it. That's the way it is. There's a standard, guys. It doesn't matter what society says. If the word says it, That's the way it is. Now some people say, oh, that's legalism. That's not legalism, that's protection. I'll say that again. That's not legalism, it's protection. In the way of righteousness, in the path, in the manner of life of righteousness. That's what that's saying in Proverbs. Is life, and there is no death. How many of you like that? I know I do. I love it. Draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you. Now, stop the rest of the part. I could hammer on that, but draw nigh or near to God, and He will draw nigh or near to you. How do you draw nigh to God? You draw nigh to His Word. What about the rest of that verse, Chris? I'm going to say this since you're seeing it. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and He will lift you up. Humble yourself in the sight of the Word, and He will lift you up. If you don't understand spirit, soul, and body, you'll never understand this, because He's not talking about your spirit. And if you read it and you go back to the beginning of this chapter, He's talking, well, let's do it. We got to do it. It's not fair not to. Verse 1. From whence come wars and fightings or quarrels among you? How does this happen, believers? Here's how it happens. Come they not hence, even of your lust that war in your members? Next verse. You lust and have not. You kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you have not because you ask not. You ask and receive not. Next verse. Because you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your own lust. Now what kind of lifestyle is this? See, this is a lifestyle that's rejecting the Word. See, a lot of people say, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. That's not what that verse says. It says, submit yourself to God, which is submitting yourself to His Word, then resist the devil, and then he'll flee from you. Boy, that's big. That's big, guys. See, if I do things my own way, it'll be Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? Amen? You ask and receive not because you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your own lust. Next verse, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know you not that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Now stop, I'm going to finish this verse and I'm going to say something. Whosoever therefore will be the friend of the world is the enemy of God. What does it mean to be the friend of the world? Oh, I know it means that's where your heart's at. See, we think of worldliness as bad movies and all that. Worldliness is basically just doing things like the world does. Not relating to God because you're a child of God. That's why the world doesn't know you. They don't. How can you be a child of God? I know you. You have to be perfect to be a child of God. Well, by the blood of Jesus, God sees you in perfection, right? But see, the world's way is relating based on who they are. And said, you're operating like that. Dog eat dog, that whole thing. He said, don't operate like that. You got a father. Amen? You're not orphans. Okay, next verse. So this is the context of how he's talking. Do you think the scripture saith in vain? The Spirit, our born-again spirit, by the Holy Spirit, dwells in us, lusteth to envy. God is a jealous God. He doesn't want to share you. Who in here wants to share their husband and wife with someone else? If you do, come up here and we'll cast it out. That's not normal. That's not normal. And it's not normal for God either. God loves you. He wants to present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. That's what those verses are talking about. Even in the book of Revelation, when you get in the 144,000 and says, these are virgins, what does that mean? They're never married? No, it means they're spiritually speaking. They're just for Him. Amen? All right. Do you think the scripture saith in vain, the Spirit dwelleth in us, lusteth envy? Next verse, but He giveth more grace. More grace to overcome these things. Amen? Wherefore, he says, God resists the proud. What is the proud? Someone who trusts in their own heart, according to Proverbs 28:26. You trust in your own heart, the proud, or you trust in the Word. Amen? I don't want to experience death in any area. Let me get to that. God resists the proud, but He gives grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Then resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Next verse. Draw nigh or near to the Word. Draw nigh to God, the Word. Draw nigh to the Word, and He will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands. Remember the beginning verses. He was talking about people who were being friends of the world. So that's what clarifies those verses. Okay? that they were trusting the world and they were trusting God. God loves you and he wants you all to himself. Amen? He loves you just like you go back in, like, for example, the book of Hosea. Hosea, God told him to marry a prostitute. Her name was Gomer. Now, with a name like, no, I'm kidding. That was before she had her sitcom. I'm just kidding. I know. But the whole point was to show Israel that they had been faithless to him under the old covenant. Amen? All right. So any area that I resist the word and I go my own way, I can experience death in that area. Here's a big one. Are you ready? When it comes to the power of the word, of our words, am I flippant with my words or do I put a value on my words? A lot of Christians just say things out of their mouth. You know what we need to do? We need to pray with the psalmist. Lord, Psalm 141, verse 3, set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth. Keep the door of my lips. You know, let me show it to you. Romans 10, 9 and 10. I want to get my thing here because I want to read this to you. Romans 10, 9 and 10. We always use these to get people born again, and that's not wrong, but boy, it's a lot more than that. Everybody say a lot more? Because I want you to see this. Romans 10, 9 and 10. And I'm going to read this to you. Because this is everybody say the power of my words. Death and life are where? Power of the tongue. Death and life are where? The power of the tongue. Now, and before we do this one, back up to verse, let's do 4, because I want to say this. Do 4, and then we'll go all the way down here. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. Say, if you're born again, you're righteous. To everyone that believeth. Next verse. For Moses describeth the righteousness which is of the law, or one's own merit, that the man which does or doeth those things shall live by them. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise. The righteousness which is of faith speaks. The righteousness which is of faith speaks. What am I saying? What's coming out of my mouth, right? I was listening to, I hate to say names sometimes, because some people think you're endorsing or not, but this a man of God was talking, and he was talking about him and his wife made a covenant with each other to start watching the words that come out of their mouth. Jen's been getting on me too. Now see, I love it, guys. I love it because that means I want to receive all that God's made available for me. I've discovered God's not the issue. It's my receiving ability. And now look at this. But the righteousness which is of faith speaks on this wise. Say not in your heart who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring Christ up again. Next verse, this is what I want you to see. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if you confess with your mouth, the word is Lord. I changed that. But it's the same thing. If you confess with your mouth, the word confess is homologiae. It means to say what God says. If you confess him as Lord in those areas, he'll be Lord in those areas. This isn't about doing, it's about agreeing with what God has already done, and you agree through your heart and your words. Amen? Oh, you just got to do more. No, you listen, declare, what does God say? What does the word say? If you confess the word is Lord in that area and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, in other words, that the work's been done, that's when you have what you say. Now watch this. I'm going to give you, there's the next one more verse, and then I'm going to give you some Greek here. For what with the heart man believes into, the Greek says, righteousness, and with the mouth confession, homologiae, say, it means to say the same thing God says, is made into, Greek, salvation. Let's look at these words here. Thou shalt be saved in verse 9. Sozo, the verb. It's soteria, the noun, in verse 10. Watch this. I've read this before, but you need to hear it. If you confess the word is Lord in any area, it says you shall be saved. To save means, sozo means to save, to keep safe and sound, to rescue from danger or destruction. If you confess the word is Lord in that area, he's guaranteed that you will reap safety from destruction. Amen. Isn't that good news? If you agree with what God's already done and said, that's why he said, set a watch before my mouth. Let me agree with what you said. The Bible says in Galatians 6, 9, we will reap in due season if we faint not. Faint not what? Declaring what God says. It doesn't matter what it looks like. God said. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now look at this. Thou shalt be saved. It means to rescue from danger or destruction. Rescue one from injury or peril. It means to save a suffering one. To save one who's suffering from disease. Wow. It means to make well. It means to heal. It means to restore to health. And this is all good. If you confess the word as Lord, Jesus as Lord, over your children, they will be safe and preserved from danger. Amen. That's awesome. That's awesome. Imagine if we believed that. We would actually talk like that. And we would see those kind of results. Whew. Well, it's just up to God. If God, you know, sometimes he does, sometimes he doesn't. That's exactly what your enemy wants you to believe. It means to you shall be saved. You'll be preserved from danger of destruction. You'll save or rescue. It means to deliver from penalties, all kinds of things. Now, the next verse, I love this. For with the heart man believes into righteousness, which is the way it should be, right standing with God, and confession, saying what God says, is made into salvation. This is the noun soteria. I love this one. Deliverance, they're both related. Preservation, safety, salvation, and this is one of my favorites. Deliverance from the molestation of enemies. How many of you do not want to be molested by the devil? Mentally, physically, in any area. Neither do I. See, but if I exalt my opinion above the word and I don't confess Jesus, the word is Lord in that area, I will reap all the miseries arising from sin both here and hereafter if I'm not born again. But I'll reap them here because I'm turning away from the word. Now, let me give you some examples. This is why teachers, do you know this is why teachers will be judged at a higher standard? Did you know that? Look at this. We'll continue talking about words. Well, words aren't that big a deal. How many know they are a big deal? Amen. You know, praise and worship, let me say this to you. Praise and worship, you know what it really is? It's your heart being expressed through words, whether you're singing them or talking them. Do you know words are containers that release life or release death? Well, I seen somebody abuse this. We're not talking about new age stuff where people, I'm not sick. That's dumb. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about truth over what's going on. We're declaring the truth. Can you imagine if God would have, on the time of creation, would have walked out instead of saying light be, would have said, man, it's dark. It would have still been dark. Right? Do you know we're created in his image? Our words have power. Before you go to James 3, go to Proverbs 18. You thought I was going to say 21, but I'm actually going to say 20. Tricked you. Proverbs 18, 20. Watch this. A man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips shall he be filled. Now watch this. If I turn away from what the word says about my words, and I don't agree with what God says, is this going to be the result? No, not at all. Look at the next verse. You know the next verse. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Once again, listen, I challenge people. My wife's been calling me out. I listen to words that come out of my mouth, and I'm telling you, a lot of times they're not good. Why? You know, we speak death. We speak these things. And then we give, that's our authority, guys. The authority God has given us. I said it earlier that praise and worship, I don't know where I'm at on time. Okay, thank you. I didn't know. A Christian wasn't here. Okay, so we speak these words. That's why praise and worship is so powerful, because it's words. Okay? Now let me show you, before we go to James, I want to show you this. Go to Psalms chapter 8, verse 2. Psalm 8, verse 2. Phew, this is so good. Now, I'm going to show you where Jesus quoted this in the New Testament. Once again, if I turn away from what God says, God's word, for my own idea and my own word, I won't experience this life in this area. You know, there's a lot of Christians that aren't happy. That ought not to be.
That's right.
Especially if you've been saved for them. Well, I'll tell you what, I used to have that zeal too, and now you kind of get. We should be on the increase, baby. If the word says it, I'm going for it. Amen. I want all that God said. But see, it's not up to God, it's up to me. God's made everything available. It's up to me how much you want on your plate. Hallelujah. Out of the mouths of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemies. Leave this up here. That thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. You know the enemy's the devil. And notice it says out of the mouths of babes. Why babes? Babes are innocent. Right? Remember what Jesus said? Except you be converted and become as little children, you'll not enter. You'll not experience the things of the kingdom of God. Right? Well, what about sucklings? You know, one of the names for God in the Old Testament is El Shaddai, the all-sufficient one, also the many-breasted one. You know what that means? God's got nourishment for every area of our life. Now watch this. He ordained strength. Everybody say strength. Now look at how Jesus quoted this in the New Testament. In Matthew chapter 21, verse 16, watch this. Same verse. He's quoting this verse. When they were saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And they were praising him. And they said, tell him to be quiet. He said, hey, the rocks would cry out. But watch this. And said unto him, hearest thou what these say? And Jesus saith unto them, yea, have you never read? We just read it. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings. He didn't say ordained strength here. He said, thou hast perfected praise. What is the perfected praise? It's the new covenant praise and worship that we have because we're born again. You have so much authority, guys. Amen? When you declare the word of God, but if I say, no, I don't believe in the power of words. I'm just going to murmur and complain. Well, God's got something for you there.
Amen.
1 Corinthians chapter 10, look at this, verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 9. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed of serpents. I don't want that. See, this ain't up to God. It's up to me. God's already given me everything. What am I going to do with it? You know, if you have a nail that you're trying to hammer in and you got a hammer on the wall and you refuse to grab the hammer and you start using your hand, how many know the hammer does you no good? Amen. Now, neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them tempted also and were destroyed of the destroyers. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured and were destroyed of the destroyer. What is that? Words. Words don't matter. Words do matter. Not just what you say, but what you hear. Praise and worship is releasing words that glorify God and glorify His Word. His Word. Jesus is even called the Word. How important are words? Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never. That is dumb. Words are big. There's people in here that are still suffering from what some negative thing someone said to them when they were a child. Give it to God. He'll heal it. He heals the broken in heart and binds up their wounds. Where did you get that from? The Word. Years ago when I went through a divorce, I leaned on that baby. God, you said you heal the broken in heart and you bind up their wounds. I stood on that. And I also stood on, it's not good that man should be alone. Guess what? It worked. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and God judged them. No, they were destroyed in the destroyer because they opened their mouth opposite of the word. It was a sin that faces death. Go to the next verse. Now all these things happened to them for ensamples or examples, and they are written for our admonition upon whom the ends of the world are come. Psalm 71, 14. Watch this. How are we at, guys? Thank you. Whenever I see what the word says, right? To rejoice in the Lord is to rejoice in His word. That's the point I'm after today. If you forget everything else I say, don't forget that. And one of the biggest things that I think is when God says stuff about the power of words, we need to agree with Him. And this isn't just mindless confession. This is praise and worship. Amen? See, we separate things. Well, I speak the word here. I praise the Lord here. They're the same thing. Praise the Lord. Amen. Watch this. But I will hope continually. How do you hope continually? And will yet praise thee more and more. And more and more. Next verse. My mouth shall murmur. No. Psalm 34, verse 1. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise is in my heart. No, His praise shall continually be in my mouth. The devil hates when you praise the Lord. When you exalt God's word above Him, he has no chance. And when all these pray, when you confess Him as Lord, when you confess the Word as Lord, when you praise God for His Word, you are exalting the Lordship of Jesus Christ. That's what it means. Years ago, I told you, I called a ministry. I've said this a while back. I remember calling a ministry, and you guys say, look at Jesus, look at Jesus. What does that mean? I really wanted to know. What does it mean to look at Jesus? Does that mean the religious pictures we see of Him, even though most theologians are pretty sure that's not what He looked like? It's certainly not what He looked like on the cross. You know where He's on the cross and He's got that trickle of blood and His hair looks like He just came from Fiesta? Right? That's not what He looked like. Isaiah said He was so marred, He didn't even look human. He was beaten and so marred for every damnable thing that you deserve and I deserve. He took it all. I think it's an insult to God when we don't receive all that He's made available. I do. See, we need to think different. Amen. We need to think. We were talking about that the other night with witnessing. People think, well, should I witness? If God leads me, I will. He's already led you. The Word says that. He already got a green light. Unless He gives you a red light, go, baby. Sure. He's already told you to pray for the sick. That's another thing. I say, well, I'm praying. Do they have enough faith? Are they born again? Or are they not born again? If you ask me to pray, I'm praying. I'm releasing the life of Christ. And whatever they can receive and can get through, it's gone. Amen. 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 I don't have to figure all this out. Unless God says no, you need to talk to them, pray for them. I'm praying. Hallelujah. See, we make it too hard. My mouth shall show forth thy righteousness. How does God's righteousness, how is it shown forth? Through our mouth. Through our mouth. But if I say no, that's what God's word says. I'm going to lean to my own word. I will experience death in that area. My mouth shall show forth thy righteousness and thy salvation all the day long, for I know not the numbers thereof. In other words, it's unsearchable. God's righteousness is so good, you can't even figure it out. You'll the ages to come will be figuring it out because it's so vast. Next verse. I love it. Here it is. I will go in the strength of the Lord God. I will make mention of thy righteousness, even of thine only. See, there's another thing that's powerful. This is what, and here again, I want to give you another one. If I turn away from God's word when it comes to praying for people, and this is deep, I know, I won't see any answers to prayers. Right? And is it because it wasn't God's will? No, it's because I didn't step out on the word. Thank you, Aaron. Watch this. So, I will make mention of thy righteousness, even of thine only. This is why we can have confidence when we pray. You know why? Because it's God's righteousness. It's been given to us as a free gift. Now, I want to say this one. If I don't pray for people, I won't see any answered prayers. If I don't lay hands on the sick or pray for the sick, I won't see any manifested healings. And this, a lot of times we, here, let, I got to deal with this one. I call it the illusion of the level. What is that? We think we have to get to this level. Can I tell you something? You're already at that level. It's called in Christ. You can't get any higher level. Now, you can understand more. We're all hopefully on that path. But see, that's the level. I used to wait to this, well, when I have this healed and I have this and all that stuff's in order, then I'll pray for people. Then I'll start releasing my faith. Then we'll have prayer group. You can't wait. God's already put you at that level. See, that's what faith is, guys. And faith is saying your word's true, no matter what anybody else's word, including my word, says, your word's true. And I'm going to act on it. Isn't that powerful? That's so simple, but so powerful. Golly, I pray you get it. But now go to John chapter 15. I'm going to quick bust through these and we'll be done. The first 8 verses, verse 1. John 15, 1. Jesus said, I am the true vine and my Father is the husbandman. Next verse. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, he lifts it up. We've talked about that before. And every branch that beareth not fruit, he purgeth it that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Now you are clean through the word. But if I say, no, I'm not clean. If I say, no, I'm not clean, my position before God is not clean. What am I saying about the blood? What am I saying about what Jesus said? Listen, look at your neighbor and say, I'm clean. That's what Jesus said. Woo! You're clean. What's that Petra song? Clean, clean, clean before the Lord. Like a spotless lamb, I'm blameless in his sight, with no trace of wrong left to right. Clean, clean. All right. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Next verse. Abide in me. In other words, keep yourself in this understanding that you're clean. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except abide in the vine. No more can ye except you abide in me. In other words, if I start putting my faith in me, I can't bear fruit. Amen? So, once again, abide in him. Next verse. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. We're going to talk about this fruit here in just a minute. We're just about done. Everybody say, much fruit. Much fruit. Amen. That's a good thing. We're going to see what this fruit is here in a few minutes. For without me, ye can do nothing. In other words, if you start trying to do it in your own strength, which is, by the way, the essence of man's religion, you know that? When man turns away, Jeremiah 2:13, it says, Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 13, he said, my people have committed two evils. Number one, they have forsaken me. They stopped, and this would apply to us, if I stop keeping my trust in Jesus, which takes effort, by the way. Amen? It takes a labor to rest, because I'll automatically go back to me. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living water, and they have hewn themselves out wells, broken wells that can hold no water. I looked at that the other day, and the Lord said, that's the essence of religion. Whenever people turn from what the Word says, they come up with some method. In fact, I was reading a book about church growth, and they basically said, I skimmed it, so I'm not going to tell you the book, but basically that the Word isn't, you know, the pulpit isn't that big a deal. You got to do other things. That's what I got. And I go, whoa, that's the problem. Anyhow, so you can, without me, you can do nothing. Next verse. What is this much fruit? Everybody say much fruit. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them, not God, and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. In other words, if they don't see any fruit, the fire of their judgment says, hey, I don't believe this is talking about hell here, okay? Because it says men do this, not God. We're just about done. Look at verse 7. If you abide in me, stay put in me, keep your faith in me, keep trusting in me, keep declaring what I say and not what you feel. If you keep doing that and my words abide in you, there it is again, words. You shall, oh, I love this. You shall ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. How many of you want your prayers answered? I do. That's what he said. If you keep your trust in me and my words are abiding in you, you can ask what you will and it's going to happen. This is the much fruit. Look at the next verse. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciples. What is the fruit? What is the fruit? What is the much fruit? Answered prayer. Amen? But if I turn away from God's way, the Word's way of doing things, and I turn to my own way, this isn't going to be the result. I'll experience death in this area. I won't experience answers. God wants us to experience answers. I've been declaring boldly, fill out them prayer slips. We want to pray for you. We want to release the life of Christ. We want to declare. Listen, I don't have to sit here, well, what if that didn't? You heard Judy. And I'm telling you, when people come, there's this temptation to say, oh, man, I'm not prayed up right. I'm not this. It ain't about you. What do you think it means to abide in Jesus? It means you keep your faith in Him and out of Chris. Or out of yourself. That's what it is. That's the fight. You keep trusting in Him. That's what the Word says. He said I was clean. I didn't say it. He said it. Now I'm agreeing with it. Amen. Hallelujah. See, that's why you go, I just had an argument with my husband or wife, and how can I pray? Don't pray in your name. Pray in His.
Amen.
Amen. That's good news. That is really, really good news. That's why He said, now you are clean through the Word which I have spoken unto you. And if you abide in Me and My words, you abide in the Word that you're clean through, you keep your trust in Me and My words through relationship, abide in You, guess what? You can ask what you will. It'll be done. The Father will be glorified. You'll bear much fruit. You'll be My disciples. Hallelujah. That's good news. So once again, the Word. The sin unto death, I believe, is when we turn from the Word to our own way of doing things. And we experience death in that area. Death in that area. The Bible says in Ephesians 6:1, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. Ooh, he's going back to the law. Ooh, what's up with that? I could hammer on that. That it may be well with you, and you live a long time upon the earth. Isn't that something? Listen, go the Word's way, and these are the results. Say, my way's better than the Word's way. I don't have to honor them. Who are they? Right? And I could go home early. Things aren't going to go well. See, the Word says this. I have a choice. God's way, the Word's way. See, when you confess Jesus as Lord, you're confessing His Word as Lord, and I am done. Praise God. Hallelujah.